as my Savior and my God. With Christ my Savior and my God.
Suffering and shame, and I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last are laid down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown.
Good day, Grace Bible Church Logan, and welcome to any others viewing in from out and about. My name is Pastor Dave, and it's Happy winter break to most of us. A lot of people are away today, so it's mostly Jason and I, not a whole lot of variety today. But in 2 weeks, we do hope to be back gathering together in person in Springwood. More details on that during announcements. But for now, we gather digitally. Hopefully some of you are in smaller groups and homes, singing together, fellowshipping together with meals afterwards. And since we're almost done with being in a studio and a video service, some people have been asking, is this background fake or are those real books? Well, I thought I'd just end the mystery. There we go. See, this is actually real. It's not a fake background. So now you know. As we get more serious, as a call to worship, I thought I'd reflect on my Bible reading from this week. And yesterday, being the 4th of the month, I was reading Proverbs 4. And the path of wisdom is set out, and Solomon writes, "Listen, my son, I'm teaching you the way of wisdom, guiding you on straight paths. When you walk, your steps will not be hindered. When you run, you will not stumble. So guard wisdom, for it is your life. Keep off the path of the wicked, for they cannot sleep unless they make someone stumble. The way of the wicked is like the darkest gloom, but the path of righteousness is like the light of dawn, shining brighter and brighter until midday. So guard your heart above else." See, God wants us to know His blessing in the path of righteousness. And with this word picture about walking and about two paths, one to pursue and one to avoid, I was struck how similar it is to Galatians 5 and the Fruit of the Spirit series that we've been considering. See, our church plan this week has been reading Galatians 5 every day, and it's the passage where Paul contrasts the glorious fruit of the Spirit with the rotten fruit of fleshly worldliness. And Paul starts the section in Galatians 5, "Walk by the Spirit, and you certainly will not carry out the desire of the flesh." And he ends the section saying, "If we're alive in the Spirit, let us also keep step with the Spirit." And that verb about keeping in step, that's used to describe cadence, walking in harmony, as you sometimes see in a military march or in a marching band. Everybody in unity of cadence. But unity in what, you see? If it's unity in wickedness, it's an ugly and horrific cadence. But when the cadence is kept with God's Spirit, well, at work in us, guarding our hearts in wisdom and in holiness, well, The cadence is glorious. The harmony is morally beautiful. And I want to encourage you as we continue in our study of the fruit of the Spirit. Keeping in step with the Spirit is worth the cost, the effort. See, our march, it is indeed a spiritual battle against sin, our sin, others' sin. But the strain of striving to keep in step with the Spirit is so worth it. I've had a few meetings this past week, and I've seen the beauty of harmony restored between brothers and sisters in their hearts at enmity or at war. Now back walking together in cadence with God's Spirit. I've heard testimonies of God growing His children in holiness, getting out of ruts of entangling sin to walk in the light of dawn. I've heard testimonies in other meetings of God's Spirit at work in people's hearts, pushing them out of their comfort zone to testify, to broadcast the excellencies of God's grace to undeserving sinners and rebels, to be pushed out of their comfort zone and to glory in it. In summary, I've seen harmonious, glorious fruit of the Spirit produced in brothers and sisters in the church by the Spirit, and that striving, that keeping in step with the Spirit is worth it. So brothers and sisters, let's press on by pressing in to the grace of God this morning as we sing His praises, as we declare His goodness and His good news, as we plead with Him to shine the light of Christ through us in a dark and needy world. And we're going to do that with songs. We're going to sing. The first one will be, Let the Nation Be Glad. As there's a line I like, as the Holy Church goes forth in the Holy Spirit's power. It's very much describing the produce or the fruit of the Spirit in God's people. And then we're going to sing Grace Alone, because it is not of us. It's God at work in us. And that's a great Trinitarian picture of God's saving work in us, the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, all at work, calling and shaping us into His image. So let's, whether you're sitting now, let's stand together and sing aloud with our hearts to our God, Let the Nations Be Glad.
Let the nation goes forth in the Holy Spirit's power, with the glories of the gospel to explain. Now we pray your kingdom come, and we pray your will be done, for the honor and the glory of your name.
With the breath.
Great truths to sing together, brothers and sisters. I can't wait to sing together. And in light of that, do pray for July 19th, 2 weeks from today. Our hope is that the school will be ready. The good news is the space limits, even with singing, they've just loosened restrictions to 4 people per square meter. And that means we can fit 200. And so we can actually just have one service. Hopefully nearly all of us can be together. So be praying in that, towards that end, that in 2 weeks we'll be face to face. In light of that, we have a prayer meeting coming up this Wednesday. Instead of being on Zoom, we've decided with the brand new loosening of restrictions, you can have 100 people in a home now. And Lynn Freudigman is keen to host on Wednesday night. So we've decided to stop switch from Zoom to in live at Lynn, 7:15 to 8:30. We'll start, we'll focus on praying. And then people can linger afterwards and have a cuppa. And we'll make sure even then to encourage safe space as we get together and honor one another in our safety. Speaking of shifting from Zoom to in person, we've only had a couple folk after Sunday service on Zoom the last few weeks, so we're going to wrap that up, and we'll be together in 2 more weeks, so we'll just hold on till then, and so there will be no more Zoom after service on Sundays. And this week coming up, what's ahead, our Bible reading, we're going to be finishing the book of Galatians, reading chapter 6 each day, a very encouraging and challenging passage to wrap up the book with. And I hope you've enjoyed that repetitious reading to see different things each day. Final announcement, we're going to have a video announcement about guess who's coming to dinner. We haven't done that at Logan. We did it for years at Holland Park before the church plant. It's one of those fun ways to break up cliques of people and to meet new people. And to, if you like surprises, you don't know where you're, if you're going to a host's home, you don't know where you're going until about 45 minutes before, and you get in the car and go on Saturday. And if you're a host, you don't know till the bell rings and people arrive. So it's great. So definitely sign up. There's a link, and you go on that, and you sign up either as a host or as a guest, and there'll be more information in the video, but I encourage you, it's a great time to fellowship. It's been a while since we've been able to do that, but also to meet new people in the church, and maybe people you wouldn't normally mix with. So we encourage you to sign up, and we'd love to have you sign up by tonight, by Sunday night, so think about that after service. Jason will remind you at the end with closing announcements to, before you go somewhere to fellowship, click on Guess Who's Coming to Dinner and register. So let's watch the video now.
Hello, brothers and sisters. My name is Giuliano, and I'm a member here at Grace Bible Church Logan. I just want to say I have missed seeing your wonderful faces on a weekly basis and worshiping with you, and I look forward to the Sunday where we can join together in praise. But until that day, we still need regular fellowship with one another, and I can personally say how much I've missed that in this time. So I want to give you an opportunity to do just that. It's called Guess Who's Coming to Dinner. Now, this is hospitality in your home or in the home of someone else in the church with a twist. So you can either nominate yourself as a host or you can nominate yourself as a guest. And we get the opportunity to have people over and to share the love of Christ with one another. Now, when is this exact opportunity opening up? Well, we are doing it on July, Saturday the 11th at 6 p.m. What do you have to do in all of this? Well, attached to the description of this video, you'll find a link that will take you to a Google document and you can register your participation. It would be wonderful to see your names, and it's through that link that I'm able to nominate you to attend the home of a host and attend as a guest. Now, you have 3 options there. It's host, guest, and either. Now, the third option, either, is really helpful for people like me who will help organize this. And so just in case we don't have enough hosts, we can use your home. Now, this is, I can personally say over the years, me and my family at Grace Bible Church Holland Park, and now at Grace Bible Church Logan. We have been blessed by the hospitality of the brothers and sisters within the church. Guess Who's Coming to Dinner has given us an opportunity to meet people that we would have otherwise not known or not have met. It is the step beyond just the Sunday gathering and is a great way to get to know each other's lives and indeed to encourage each other in the Lord over a meal. Just as we see in Holy Scripture, as Jesus did with his disciples, and as Paul exhorts the believers to do in the churches, we are called to gather and be hospitable with one another. I can't encourage you enough to join me and other members of the church as we participate in Guess Who's Coming to Dinner. It will be a great opportunity, and I look forward to seeing you there.
Now's the section in our service where through the year we've been going through the New City Catechism, a new question each week, and we're up to the question number 27, which is, as all people were lost through Adam, are all people saved through Christ? That's an important question, and here's the important answer. No, only those who are elected by God and united to Christ by faith. Nevertheless, God in his mercy demonstrates common grace even to those who are not elect by restraining the effects of sin and enabling works of culture for human well-being. Now, there's a lot in there. Not everyone will be saved. This is taught so clearly in the Bible in so many places. And this is quite a sobering and an urgent question and answer, revealing a clear biblical balance, that on the one hand, to display God's justice, he allows some to receive the deserved consequence of sin, condemnation and eternal death. But on the other hand, to display God's mercy, he chooses or elects some to be graciously spared the consequences of their sin and have salvation, eternal life. The Bible puts it like this: if by one man's sin, that's Adam's sin, death reigned through that one man, how much more will those who receive the overflow of grace and the gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ? See, there's two Adams here, if you will. The original Adam, speaking of humanity's rebellion in the Garden of Eden, Adam brought sin and curse into God's good creation. But salvation is found in Jesus Christ, whom the Bible describes as a second Adam, the head of a new humanity, a saved and redeemed humanity being transformed to cultivate God's holiness and grandeur in the world to his glory and to people's good, and then to spend eternity with God and his people. Not everyone will be saved yet. God, in his grace, does not allow a rebellious humanity to be as bad as it can be. God shows grace to the whole human race. Let me say that again. God shows grace to the whole human race, and that is called common grace. The answer to question 27 says that in his common grace, God restrains the effects of sin and enables works of culture for human well-being. That's for all of creation. See, to restrain evil, God gives everyone a conscience. And Romans 2, verse 15 says, God writes the work of his law on everyone's hearts. Above that, the Holy Spirit convicts the world of sin and righteousness and judgment. And so God in his grace does all of that to curb or restrain the wickedness of the human heart. And more than restraining evil, for good to flourish, in God's common grace, he sends rain and sunshine on the wicked and the righteous, the elect and the non-elect alike. And God grants wisdom to all, enabling works of culture and cultivation. For example, one amazing passage from Isaiah 28 says this: "Pay attention and hear what I say. Does the farmer plow every day to plant seed? Does he continually break up and cultivate the soil? No. Once he's leveled the surface, does he not then scatter seed? Does he not plant wheat in rows and barley in its plot and spelt along the border? God instructs him and teaches him the right way. This is from the Lord who gives great wisdom." You see, God is gracious to all, and he grants wisdom to all to bless the world so that it's not as bad as it could be. We have a gracious God. He shows grace to the whole human race, but to some, he shows an extra, an uncommon grace, an eternal grace to save us from sin's condemnation, a saving grace, not because of anything in us, no merit in us, only because of his love and mercy. Read Romans chapter 9 this week if you'd like an insight into that. But our new City Catechism, question and answer 27, reminds us there's only two groups of people in the world. And this is summarized in a verse from the Bible, 1 John 5:11. This is the testimony. God gives eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. God shows special grace to his chosen or elect. And since God shows common grace to the whole human race, we, his people in Christ, are likewise called to show grace even to our enemies, like God does. May it be so this week, brothers and sisters, as we reflect on this catechism, as we respond to God in praise for his special grace and imitate his common grace to the world. Well, I'm going to pray, and then we'll get to our scripture reading. Our Father in heaven, how good it is to speak of our good and gracious God. Because of the grace given us to your Son, in your Son, Jesus, your word, Scripture, tells us, let us approach the throne of grace with boldness so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in our time of need. Thank you, Lord, for your throne of grace that we can approach in Christ, in whom is life. Lord, it's a throne of grace. That means it's a throne. You are the King of kings and Lord of lords, enthroned, worthy of praise, worthy of pleading. It is a throne of grace, welcoming every rebel and sinner who trusts in Jesus' righteousness to be made right with you, adopted by grace, forgiven, cleansed. How good you are to your people. Lord, we pray in light of common grace. We pray for the world. We ask that, Lord, over all creation, including this planet, Lord, let the nations be glad when they hear the good news of Jesus. We pray your word would go forth and people would respond and trust in Christ. Thank you for sharing your good news with everyone, even with those who will not bow the knee, who refuse to worship you. You still broadcast your goodness to them. Lord, we pray for our nation. We pray that you would bring revival in it. But we also, in these tough times, we want to thank you for our government and just praise you for the job that they are doing. We look on the news, we look around the world, and frankly, it's hard not to be grateful for the way our elected officials are governing us in the tricky times that we're in with physical health and COVID, with economic health, with psychological and what we call spiritual health of fellowship and isolation and needing people and needing you. Lord, they're doing a good job. Grant them an extra grace, we pray. And we praise you for them, and may we encourage them in their efforts. And we continue to plead for our nation to rise up and to love one another in these times, to consider others in their wellness, putting our liberties aside for the good of the nation. Lord, we pray finally for the church. We want to maintain that love for one another. How desperately we want to get together and hug each other, shake hands, and Lord, we still need to be careful. And so give us the fruit of the Spirit called self-control as we regather to consider others. Some are at risk, but we also don't want to be a cause of this virus having a second wave and flourishing. So give us self-control to rejoice in being together, but to love each other with some safe distance. Lord, we pray specifically for the 19th, that you would grant us the ability to be all together back at the school, singing praises, not alone anymore in our room, hearing our joyful noise, and a noise it is. We hope it's been joyful, but to hear the whole chorus of saints in the church praising you and to be able to catch up and to see faces that we've missed and encourage one another. Oh, Lord, bring that day, we pray, on the 19th. May the school be ready. And Lord, now ready us to hear your word, to understand the fruit of the Spirit called gentleness, what it doesn't mean and what it does mean, and may we desire to keep in step with your Spirit in the virtue of gentleness. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Well, now it's time for our scripture reading to prepare our minds for the message from God in the sermon. And that's going to be a couple of passages. Kailani is going to be reading those two brief sections of scripture, and I invite her now to come and do that.
Good morning, Grace Bible Church. I'm Kai, a member, and if I haven't met you yet, pleased to meet you through the screen. This morning, we are reading two passages. The first passage is from Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 through to 30, and our second passage is Hebrew 4, verses 14 through to 16. So let's start at Matthew 11, verse 28. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take up my yoke and learn from me, because I am lowly and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Now over to Hebrews 4, verses 14. Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has been tempted in every way as we are, yet without sin. Therefore, let us approach the throne of grace with boldness so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in time of need. This is the word of the Lord.
Well, good morning, church. Jason here, one of the elders at Grace Bible Church Logan. It's a privilege to be able to bring the word of God to you this morning. But before I do, how about I say another quick word of prayer? If you would bow your heads with me and pray, that'd be great. Our good and gracious God, we thank you for the kindness that you've already shown us today. We thank you for the blessings that you've shown us, that we can even interact in this way through the screen. We thank you for what's come before and the singing and the praying and the reading. And now we ask, Lord, for what comes ahead, that you would indeed use my words. May I disappear through this, but may your words stay true. And may they ring out in our heart. I pray that your Holy Spirit would be at work in our hearts, changing us to be more like Jesus. And we pray in his name. Amen. Well, we've already heard from the book of Proverbs this morning, but I'm actually going to start our sermon again in the book of Proverbs. See, Solomon in the book of Proverbs writes to his son, and he warns him about the dangers of laziness. They will end in ruin, and they will end in poverty. He tells his son to look to the ant. And in chapter 6, this is what he says. He says, "Go to the ant, you slacker. Observe its ways and become wise. It prepares provisions in summer and gathers food in the harvest time. See, the tiny ant provides a great lesson to those who are lazy. Well, this morning we're going to take a leaf out of the book of Proverbs, and instead of turning to the tiny ant, we're going to turn to the not-so-tiny elephant, or an elephant. Here we go. To the one who lacks gentleness, I say this, go to the elephant, the largest and the most powerful of all land animals. Yet with a simple movement, its trunk can lift up a tree, yet with gentle precision, it can pick up a blade of grass. It doesn't use its size and strength to dominate and devour its foes. Rather, it uses its great size, its great stature, to protect and guard those who are vulnerable within its herd. See, the elephant provides a good lesson to any who lack gentleness, and it's a lesson that I want us to hear this morning. Well, if you've been following along with us over the last couple of weeks, Dave's already referred to it. We've been working through the fruit of the Spirit listed in Galatians 5. In Galatians 5, Paul highlights to his readers the contrast between the works of the flesh and the fruit of the godly, the fruit that the Holy Spirit produces in the Christian, the one who keeps in step with the Spirit. And so we've made our way through 6 of the 9 fruit, and today we find ourselves looking at the spiritual fruit of gentleness. Now, I'm sure that some of you may have heard of the term forbidden fruit. See, the spiritual fruit of gentleness could probably be referred to as the forgotten fruit. See, in the list of fruits listed in Galatians 5, it often just falls into the shadows. It gets grouped with things like kindness, goodness, and faithfulness. So much so that we forget to even pursue it as Christians. See, when a parent rouses at their child for misbehaving or whatever it may be, they ask that the Lord would give them patience. When we find ourselves stumbling over the same besetting sins, we ask that the Lord would give us self-control. We pray for courage when we share the gospel, and we ask that the Lord would help us to remain faithful. And of course, we all pray that we would love as the Lord Jesus calls us to love. But rarely do we hear a heartfelt prayer or an earnest longing that the Lord would make us gentle. Now, I know this is the case because until a few weeks ago, I rarely prayed for the spirit of gentleness. But I'm hoping after this morning that this will no longer be the case for you or for I. Because today I want us to see the great value in the virtue of gentleness. And that brings us to our main point for this morning. Christ-like gentleness shows great strength through compassion to the weak. Let me read it again. A Christ-like gentleness shows great strength through compassion to the weak. Now, as I've mentioned, I think the topic of gentleness often goes undervalued in the Christian walk. And I think this happens for a number of reasons, but I'm going to talk about at least 2. See, firstly, I think people don't fully understand what gentleness is. So this morning, we're going to ask the question and answer the question, what is gentleness? See, secondly, I think people don't value what gentleness is because of the world we live in. So we live in a world of supply and demand. We live in a world of rules and rights. We live in a real world where the strong are said to win. And so the idea of gentleness falls into the shadows. It's overtaken by other virtues which we see are more important. So this morning we're going to answer questions like, why is gentleness so important? What does Jesus have to do with gentleness? How is the church called to be gentle? And as well, how do I become more gentle? So that's a picture of where we're going to head throughout our sermon. And that's actually going to form more or less the basis for, or the points for our sermon, which you'll see on your screen right now. Firstly, we're going to look at gentleness defined in Scripture. Then we're going to look at gentleness displayed in Christ. And then I will close our sermon this morning at looking at the importance of gentleness being demonstrated in His body. So if you're taking notes, that's definition, display, and demonstration. But now let's turn to our first point, gentleness defined in Scripture. What does the word gentleness or gentle mean to you? Maybe when you hear the word gentle, you might think of a newborn baby. A baby needs to be handled gently because a baby is very fragile. See, when a toddler holds a baby, especially a newborn baby, the first thing that you'll hear out of his parents' mouth is, be gentle. Maybe you're picturing yourself on holidays, as some people are this week. Maybe you're reading a book under a tree and you're thinking of a gentle breeze, which is keeping you cool. Maybe you're thinking of the well-known proverb in Proverbs 15, verse 1, a gentle answer turns away anger, but a harsh word stirs up wrath. What about when you think of gentleness as a character trait? See, I think most of us generally think of someone who is warm-hearted, possibly someone who is softly spoken, nurturing and caring. Now, fortunately for us, all these characteristics still hold a sense of value in the world we live in. They're generally respected and welcomed. What is unfortunate for us is, though, these characteristics are often associated with femininity, those who may be a little bit less than manly. And so almost all these characteristics are desired, but they're desired in other people, not us. We want to get ahead. See, the world we live in is surrounded with strength. Strength is admired. We need to have strong wills and determinations to get ahead in life. We admire those who have strength and endure adversity and rise to the top. We admire those who have trained their bodies and they are strong in competition. Strength in our modern world is associated with success. This, of course, can leave a quality, a virtue like gentleness, seen as something that lacks. It leaves the trait of gentleness being associated with someone who is weak, someone who is feeble, not very manly at all, and of course not strong. However, this would be the furthest thing from the truth. See, the word gentleness in Greek, or praotes, is a word that's generally associated with humility and with thankfulness towards God. It's often likened to meekness and thoughtfulness, and sometimes you'll see that in different translations. The word is associated also with politeness and, importantly, the restraint of power. See, outside the Bible, in everyday language of the ancient world, gentleness was a term given to someone wasn't given to someone who was weak and feeble. It wasn't given to those who were slaves or those who were sick. Rather, it was given to one who was a high official, someone who was a commander of an army, someone who had strength but restrained their actions to think about those who were around them, to consider others instead of ruling with stubbornness and pride. See, gentle was the title given to someone who knew how to restrain their power for the good of others. And this is why in Scripture we often see gentleness set in contrast with pride and stubbornness. And we see this in our passage in Galatians 5. See, in Galatians 5, Dave's already referred to it, but in Galatians 5, 19 and 20, Paul lists the works of the flesh. These are the things that someone does when they walk in the flesh. And among them, he names things like fits of rage and self-ambition. Then he lists the fruit of the Spirit, in which he names gentleness. Gentleness is in opposition to outbursts of anger. It's in opposition to a desire for revenge. Gentleness is opposed to pride. It's opposed to self-aggrandizement. And so gentleness not only requires someone to be strong, it also requires someone to do so humbly. Gentle people have power, but you would never realize that they had power by looking at them. It requires someone of strength to not consider their self or their own strength as a means of self-gain, but rather an ability to do good to others. See, gentleness is defined in Scripture as this: power under control used for the good of others. And we see an example of this in the Apostle Paul. He writes to the church in Thessalonica. He says this in 1 Thessalonians 2, 3 through 7. He says, "For our exhortation did not come with error or impurity or an intent to deceive. Instead, just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel, so we speak, not to please people, but rather to please God, who examines our heart. For we never used flattering speech, as you know, or we didn't have greedy motives. God is our witness. We didn't seek glory from people, either from you or from others. In verse 7, he says, although we could have been a burden as Christ's apostles, instead we were gentle among you, as a nurse nurtures her own children. See, Paul, as an apostle of Christ, had authority. He could have lauded his power over them. He could have demanded their care, their aid, and of their praise. Yet he, the Apostle Paul, in bearing the name of Christ, his Lord, came to them gently, as a nurse nursing her own children. See, gentleness defined in Scripture is power under control. Gentleness, as defined by Scripture, seeks the welfare of the weak and the vulnerable. And it does so in tenderness, in concern, and in love and affection. We see this in the Apostle Paul, who had authority as an apostle, but we see this most clearly in the Lord Jesus himself, who had supreme authority, yet in humility deals with us gently. And it's to him that we turn our attention now. So we turn to our second point, gentleness displayed in Christ. When you line up the four Gospels side by side, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, you have 89 chapters of biblical text. Now, in this text, we read about the birth of Jesus. We read about his ministry. We read about the lives of his disciples. We learn about how Jesus traveled back and forth through Judea, preaching and teaching about the kingdom of God. We learn about how Jesus fulfilled the Old Testament prophecies about him. We learned about the miracles that he performed. On top of this, these 89 chapters have been the cause of countless theologians writing countless books on the life of Christ. But see, within these 89 chapters, with all this information, with all these details, there's only one place where the Lord Jesus tells us about his own heart. And we read it earlier. Let's read it again in Matthew chapter 11, verse 28 through 30. He says, come to me, all who labor, who are heavy laden. I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart. And you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. You know, I love what one author, Dane Ortlund, says in his commentary on this verse. He says this, in one place in the Bible where the Son of God pulls back the veil, he lets us peer way down deep into the core of who he is. When we do it, we're not told that he is strict and demanding in heart. We're not told that he is exalted and dignified in heart. We're not even told that he is joyful and generous in heart. See, letting Jesus set the terms, his surprising claim is this, I am gentle and lowly in heart. Brothers and sisters, I can't express with words how good of a thing this is. See, if there's one thing that we need, an all-knowing, all-powerful, a holy and just God to be towards us, it's gentle. Let us spend just a few moments looking at how Jesus displays his gentleness towards us, and also whom he displays it to. I'm going to look at three ways that Jesus displays gentleness to us. First is this, he provides grace to the humble. You know, if you read through the Gospels, you begin to notice that the crowds are divided into at least three people. You'll notice that Jesus interacts with these people, these crowds, in different ways. The first crowd you have is the leaders of the religion, the Pharisees and the Jewish leaders. See, when Jesus deals with these leaders, he's always on guard. He understands that they're seeking to trick him. They want to catch him up on his words. To these, Jesus pronounces a scathing judgment. He calls them for what they are. And in Luke 11, we see a little bit of this. In Luke 11, he announces a series of woes or a series of judgments upon them. He says things like this, verse 39, you Pharisees make yourselves look clean on the outside, but you are full of greed and evil, you fools. Verse 42, you Pharisees, you tithe of the small spices that you have, but you bypass and ignore the justice and love of God. Woe to you. Verse 43, You Pharisees love attention. You sit at the front of the synagogue so people make much of you. Woe to you. But in reality, Jesus says this in verse 44, you are unmarked graves. Your judgment has already been announced and you don't even realize it. See, to the proud, to the arrogant, to those who claim that they are well and no need of help, to these, God gives them what they deserve, judgment. He gives them what they've earned, judgment. The second crowd we see throughout the Gospels is this. They're the exploiters of religion. These are those who follow Jesus because they know they might receive a miracle on the way. See, when you read the Gospel, this crowd, sometimes it's hard to identify. You often find them following Jesus for a while, and then when things get a little bit too intense, they disappear off the scene. A classic example of this is in John chapter 6. Jesus has just fed them over the other side of the Sea of Galilee. You know the miracle, over 5,000 people, 5 loaves, 2 small fish. The crowd was so impressed that overnight they hiked around the top end of the Sea of Galilee just so they could come for another feed in the morning. And Jesus rebukes them for it. He tells them this in verse 26. He says, I tell you, you're looking for me, not because you saw the signs, but because you ate the loaves and had your fill. See, this group of people were not interested in the fact that these signs and these miracles pointed to Jesus as their Messiah. Rather, they were simply interested in being fed. We know this because when Jesus starts to turn up the heat, they disappear. See, the exploiters of religion, Jesus pronounces judgment. He tells them this in Matthew 11, verse 23 and 24. He says, if the miracles that I had done were done in the time of Sodom, it would have remained until today. They would have repented because they knew who had come. But I tell you, it'll be more tolerable for the land of Sodom than it will be for you on judgment day. See, the exploiters of religion are those who only want miracles. And Jesus gives them what they deserve, judgment. But see, the last crowd of people that we see in the gospel are the humble. The humble, the repentant. There are these who come to Jesus in their brokenness, realizing their state before him. And to them, he says what we said in our passage earlier, Matthew 11, verse 28 to 30. He says, come to me, all who labor or who are heavy laden, I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon me. Take my yoke upon you. Learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart. You'll find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. See, the grace that Jesus offers, is not given to everyone. Again, we've already heard about that this morning. The rest that he gives is not offered to the proud. See, the rest that he offers, it's not offered to those who seek to purchase it with money or with deed. It's not offered to those who try to work to obtain it. It's not offered to those who even clean themselves up before they come to Christ. It's offered to those who come to Jesus. The gentleness of Christ invites all who are burdened to come. The gentleness of Christ offers all who are weary to come. The gentleness of Christ offers rest for the soul. The second way that Jesus displays gentleness is this. He experiences our lowliness. You know, there can be a tendency for those who have been hurt, especially emotionally, to distance themselves from everyone. See, when someone is abused, they have a tendency to seek the counsel of someone who was abused, an abuse victim. When someone's being betrayed, they have the tendency to want the counsel from someone else who has been betrayed. When someone's been bullied or teased, there can be a tendency to want counsel and comfort from someone who has been bullied. See, when we go through pain, when we go through suffering, when we go through abuse, we want to hear from someone who's experienced that pain. And I understand. We want to know that your feeling can be overcome. So we look to someone who's had that feeling, who knows what it was like. We want to know that the disappointment will pass. We want someone who can sympathize with our sorrows, someone who knows how it feels, because only then can they deal gently with me. And brothers and sisters, what a savior we have. Jesus doesn't just put on an outfit. He doesn't just pretend to experience our lowliness. No, he became lowly for us. Listen afresh to what the preacher says in the book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 2, 17 and 18, he says this, "Therefore Jesus had to be like his brothers and sisters in every way, so that he could become a merciful and faithful high priest in the service of God, to make atonement for the sins of people. For since he himself suffered when he was tempted, he is able to help those who are tempted." Again in Hebrews 4, 15 and 16, we read it earlier, "For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weakness, but one who has at all points been tempted as we are, yet is without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace in our time of need." See, brothers and sisters, Jesus doesn't just act lowly and gentle towards us out of sympathy for our lowly position. Jesus acts gently and sympathetically with us because he was made low. He can sympathize with our weaknesses. When he does this, he's doing what comes naturally to him. This is why we're invited to come to him. He knows what it means. Jesus knows what it means to be lowly because he became lowly. The lowliness of Christ, the gentleness of Christ, they're not just masks that Jesus puts on for our sake. They are who he is. Jesus displays gentleness by experiencing our lowliness. Let us look briefly at the third way that Jesus displays gentleness towards us. He deals delicately with the fragile. You know, throughout the scriptures, God is said to be as a shepherd over his people. Now, he's not a cruel shepherd who neglects his flock. Rather, he's a loving and a caring shepherd, one who tends to his flock. So we're told this in Isaiah 40, verse 11. It says that God protects his flock like a shepherd. He gathers the lambs in his arms and he carries them in the fold of his garments. He gently leads those who are nursing. See, if this is a picture of our loving shepherd who tenderly cares for his flock, it would come to us no surprise that this is a picture of Jesus as our good shepherd, who also deals with us in the same manner. So we're told in Matthew 12, verse 20, quoting from Isaiah 42, verse 3, that Jesus is so delicate with the fragile that he will not even break a bruised reed. He will not put out a smoldering wick. Jesus takes no pleasure in cutting down the hurting. He takes no pleasure in snuffing out the vulnerable. Rather, he delights to care for the broken. We're told in Psalm 34, verse 18, that the Lord is near to the brokenhearted, and he saves those who are crushed in the spirit. See, brothers and sisters, Jesus displays great strength in being gentle, by dealing with us graciously and humbly, by experiencing our sorrow and our loneliness and caring for us tenderly, even when we are broken. But now let's turn our attention to our last point, which is gentleness demonstrated in his body. In the New Testament, the church is often referred to as the body of Christ, so much so that in Scripture, to harm the church to bring harm to Christ. We see this in the conversion of Saul on the road to Damascus. See, in Acts 9, we're told the account of when Saul, the persecutor of the church, meets the risen Lord Christ. And Saul, known now as the Apostle Paul, was on his way to persecute Christians to bring harm to the church. And he is stopped on the road by Jesus, who made a bright light flash, and he was knocked off his horse. And then a voice echoed from heaven and said, "Saul, Saul," and it was the Lord Jesus. But he says, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" See, Jesus considers the church so much a part of him that to bring harm and to mistreat the church is to bring harm and mistreat himself. So, understanding this should make us think many things. Primarily, it should make us regard the church in a higher esteem than we often do. But it should also make us think about more seriously that the church, that is, you and I, are the walking, talking body of Christ on earth. With this privilege comes great responsibility, so much so that God, in his great wisdom, sent his Spirit to help guide us, to live in us, to carry out this mandate. And this is why at the end of the fruit of the Spirit, the list of the fruit of the Spirit, Paul says, we who live by the Spirit or have life by the Spirit, we should now keep in step with what the Spirit wants. And so if the very heart of Jesus is gentle and lowly, it would only make sense that his followers would be gentle and lowly also. See, now the issue is when you preach through a list of virtues like we've been doing over the last couple of weeks, see, it's often hard to imagine what Paul has in mind when he wrote what he did. However, when it comes to the fruit of gentleness, we're in luck because Paul tells us exactly what he has in mind, or at least he gives a scenario. If you have your Bibles, please turn to chapter 6. It's going to be up on the screen. I'm just going to read two verses, though. So Galatians chapter 6, verse 1 and 2 says this. Brothers and sisters, if someone is overtaken in any wrongdoing or any sin, you who are spiritual should restore such a person with a gentle spirit, watching out for yourselves so that you won't be tempted. Carry out one another's burden. Carrying one another's burdens, in this way you fulfill the law of Christ. Paul gives to his readers a scenario. He says, if there's someone who is overtaken by sin, that is, they've lost complete control, you who are spiritual need to restore him. Now, if that's all that Paul said, there's no doubt that we would come up with a litany of ways in which we would seek to restore someone. See, I know I would likely defer to my default of demand and require, to use my size and my strength to imitate, to intimidate them into piety, as if that works. It doesn't work. See, this is the exact opposite thing that Christ did, and it's the exact opposite thing that he wants us to do. He tells them how they should be restored. He says, you who are spiritual should restore that person with a spirit of gentleness. Because there's a truth here. It's this. You don't fix a broken vase with a hammer. You fix it with glue. So you don't fix a broken person by ranting and raving. You don't fix a broken person by yelling and screaming or intimidating or threats. You do it with gentleness. You do it with empathy. You do it with care and concern for their well-being. The goal of restoration is restoration. Interestingly here, Paul, he says to those who are spiritual, they should be the ones to restore. Paul wants those who are keeping in step with the Spirit to now demonstrate that indeed they are walking in step with the Spirit. See, in their gentle restoration, they should be careful to not be overcome with pride and fall into temptation themselves. In caring for one another in this way, the church, you and I, we fulfill the law of Christ. But gentleness displayed in the church just doesn't have to be about restoring someone from sin. See, gentleness should be characteristic of the life of a Christian. Gentleness is something we're called to put on. We're called to walk in gentleness towards one another. See, in Ephesians 4, we're told this, walk worthy of the calling you've received, with all humility, gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit. Likewise, in Colossians, it says this, Colossians 3, verse 12 through 14, as God's chosen ones, holy and dearly loved, put on compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience, bearing with one another, forgiving one another. If anyone has a grievance against one another, just as the Lord has forgiven you, you should now also forgive. See, the humbling reminder of these passages is not only are we to do this in the life of the church, but our demonstration of gentleness extends outside the walls of the church. So we're told in Philippians 4:5 that we are to let our graciousness or our gentleness be known to everyone. See, even when we're told to give a defense for the hope that's within us in 1 Peter 3:15, we're reminded in verse 16 that we're to do so with gentleness and reverence, keeping a clear conscience so that we, who when we're cursed, for those who accuse us, see our good conduct and the name of Christ will not be put to shame. See, there can be times when Christians are often more interested in winning an argument than they are in displaying the character of Christ. Let us remember that whether we're in the church or outside the church, showing the fruit of gentleness is always in need. You know, see, Christ displays the great strength of gentleness in showing compassion on us who are weak. Now, the church is called to demonstrate gentleness, to show them the great compassion of Christ. That's what they need. You know, I'm sure there's been people listening to my sermon throughout the morning, and they've thought to themselves, you know what, I'm just not the gentle type. That's not me. See, I'm more of a get in there, stir the feathers type of person. I'm a mover and a shaker. I want to get stuff done. Can I encourage you to reconsider the gentleness of our Lord before you discount the need for gentleness? You know, you watch the same news I do. You read the same Facebook posts that I do. And I often wonder if a lot of the current problems in our world may have been done away with if people responded to one another in gentleness. I often wonder if some of the issues that face the church would be done away with if people responded to one another in gentleness. It's probably the same for our marriages, probably the same for our families, probably the same for our friendships, whether they be at school, university, or the workplace. I wonder if half the problems that we find and we face would have been done away with if we would respond with gentleness. See, that there's others here this morning who are listening, and you do value the great strength of gentleness, but you're wondering, how is it that I become more gentle? You're asking the question, how do I grow gentleness in my life? Well, I want to leave you with a couple of things to aid you as you continue to live for Christ. See, to grow in gentleness, we must be committed to keeping our eyes fixed on our gentle Lord Jesus. We need to think more about the Lord Jesus, the gentleness that he shows us. We need to marvel again at the fact that he who has all power, all authority, all glory, all honor, he could have arrived on earth with guns blazing. He could have come with judgment. But yet he comes in lowliness, comes with gentleness, comes in humility, so he could deal with us, so we understood. See, to grow in gentleness, we need to keep our eyes fixed on our gentle Saviour. Second thing we need to do to grow in gentleness is this. We need to desire to be gentle. The fruit of gentleness is something that the Spirit wants to develop in his people. But it's also something we're called to walk in. We've highlighted a couple of verses of that already. So we're called to keep in step with the Spirit. This means we need to commit ourselves to the things of God. We will not become more gentle if we're not to be committed to becoming more Christ-like. The third thing is this, and sometimes it's the hardest thing. We need to be humble enough to confess the times when we aren't gentle. This can be a really hard pill to swallow. But it's a pill that we need to swallow if we want to grow in Christ's likeness. See, sometimes we may think we're being gentle when we really aren't. Some of us are going to have to work hard to be perceived as gentle because of our gruff exteriors. I know this all too well. You know, a few weeks back, my family and I, we were eating dinner as we usually do around the table, and my wife asked the kids, do you think Dad looks happy all the time or grumpy? And of course, you can imagine what they said. They said, I look grumpy. Now, I admit I have a grumpy resting face and I have fairly bad body language, but I need to make an extra effort to be gentle. At times, we may need to do a bit of a gentle checkup test. We need to ask ourselves questions like this. Am I sensitive to other people's rights and feelings? Are people relaxed around me, or do they feel tensed because of my countenance? Do I look down on people who are weaker than me? Or do I look down on people who struggle with different sins than I do? Is my speech blunt and abrupt instead of thoughtful and measured? Would someone I know and someone I love be willing to confess their sin to me? Or out of fear of harsh judgment, would they keep it under wraps? Now, these are tough questions to ask. But if we're committed to growing in gentleness, they're questions that we need to ask. Things that we need to assess ourselves on and in humility come before the Lord, sometimes even come before others and ask for help. Let us remember, Christ-like gentleness shows its great strength through compassion to the weak. With that, let me pray. Our gracious God and Heavenly Father, we thank you for your Son. We know that your Son is deserving of all honor and all glory. All praise is due to him. This was always the case, and it always will be the case. But we thank you that your Son put on flesh in the Lord Jesus, that he came and lived among us to experience, to know what it meant to be us, so he could sympathize with us. We thank you that Jesus was gentle and lowly, and we ask that by the power of your Spirit, you would help us to be gentle. Help our words be seasoned with grace. Help us love and care for one another in tenderness, and help us do so not only to the world inside the walls of our church, but also to those outside the church. Help us be marked with the characteristics of Christ our Lord. It's in his name we pray. Amen. You know, before I ask you to stand and sing, there's one last thing I wanted to encourage you with. You know, from time to time, you'll hear one of us from the pulpit recommend a resource. Well, today I want to recommend two resources. There are two books that I read in preparation for this sermon series, and I want to commend them to you. The first book is a book by Jerry Bridges. It's called A Fruitful Life. It looks at the fruit of the Spirit as listed in Galatians 5, but also other characteristics that the Christian should have and how he develops them, how he grows them, how he seeks to be more like Christ. And the second book is a book by Dane Ortlund called Gentle and Lowly. Sorry, it's a really good book. I read it a couple of weeks ago. Dane slows down. He takes a long look at the heart of Christ and his care for sinners and sufferers in this world. Now, I'm sure you'll be able to get a hold of those resources if you want them, whether they be online or whether they be at the local bookstore. But there are two things that I wanted to leave you and encourage you with as we grow into Christ-likeness. So that's it for me for now. But I do invite you, if you're able, would you stand with me? We're going to sing one last song in reflection of who Christ is and in praise to him called Before the Throne. So stand with me if you're able. Thank you.
Before the throne of God above, I hide.
Well, I hope you enjoyed reflecting upon that song, wherever you may be. Now, Dave made a bunch of announcements before, but a couple of things I want to remind you of. This week, Galatians chapter 6. Galatians chapter 6, every day of the week, see if you can do the challenge. I'm sure you'll be rewarded as much as we've been as we've gone through the rest of the chapters. Another thing, guess who's coming to dinner? Tonight is the night where you need to make sure you register for that. So all the details have been put on Facebook. If you have any trouble trying to get to them, shoot an email across to the church, whether to me or to Dave. Shoot us an email and we'll make sure we point you in the right direction. Other than that, I pray that your week goes well and may you honour the Lord with whatever you do.